This is to all those who've been listening to Old Time Radio that I've been podcasting for 12 years. It's time for you to purchase the Old Time Radio collection now at the lowest prices ever. 500 gigabyte external hard drive chock full of radio shows that we all love. And don't forget the bonuses. Here's my offer. I need everyone who hears my voice to go to OldTimeRadioDVD.com to place your order today. With every order, I will include a comprehensive show guide with episode descriptions. Over 1,982 pages. This is truly once-in-a-lifetime deal. Place your order today at OldTimeRadioDVD.com. You will be glad you did.
I'm the Comic Weekly Man, the Jolly Comic Weekly Man, and I'm here to read the funnies to you happy boys and honeys. Yes, boys and girls, it's Comic Weekly time, and here I come right into your house to bring a little fun and happiness, right out of the pages of Puck the Comic Weekly, straight into your living room, your friend the Comic Weekly Man, the Jolly Comic Weekly Man. Hello, hello, hello.
Hello, hello, hello.
Little Miss Honey, how are you today?
Oh, I just can't wait.
Can't wait for what?
All week long, I've been wondering what's going to happen to Flash Gordon.
Well, if you're that worried about Flash Gordon, suppose we read the funnies right away.
Oh, please do.
Very well, here we go with Puck the Comic Weekly. But first, here's that nice man with something interesting to say. Well, have all you kids got Puck the Comic Weekly spread out in front of you? Oh, good. Here we go on the first page with little Snookums. His father, Archie, is showing him how to play baseball, and he breaks a neighbor's window, and the neighbor gets plenty mad.
I guess Archie doesn't know how to play baseball.
I should say not.
And now, will you please turn over to Flash Gordon? Because Flash has been captured again by that bad man, Zinn.
And Zinn sent Flash into the Liquigen chamber to breathe the smoke that would make him lose his willpower and do anything that Zinn wanted him to do.
But Rubia gave Flash something to put in his nose so that he wouldn't breathe that gas.
But Flash pretends that he has breathed the gas, and Zinn believes that Flash is now in his power.
So please, let's find out what Zinn's going to do with Flash.
Very well, here we go with Flash Gordon.
Magic words for the music, please.
Very well, my lady. Rig-a-rig-a-doon-doon, Saskamatash. Let's have music for heroic Flash. Rubia has taken Flash out of the slave barracks where Zinn has placed him. She tells Flash she saved him from the slave gas because she loves him. Flash answers coldly, "You say that Dale is dead. Well, if she is, you and Zinn caused her death, and I'll never forgive you." Ruby becomes angry and tells Flash she'll send him back to the gas chamber herself, but she quickly stops her tirade and whispers that Zinn is coming. Flash again pretends to be a slave zombie and watches for his chance to outwit both Rubia and Zinn. Last picture top row, Zinn stops when he sees Ruby and Flash and says angrily,
"Rubia, you romantic fool! Keep away from Gordon! I need him as my stooge to conquer Mongo. Flash, march back to the slave barracks."
Flash pretends to obey. To test Flash, Zinn, first picture bottom row, leads him past the walled area where Dale is kept prisoner. Dale sees Flash and cries out to him. When Flash hears her voice, he almost stumbles, but marches away like an automaton, not daring to turn his head. For if he does, Zinn would know that Flash is not really under the spell of the Liquigen gas. Zinn leads Flash to the slave barracks, saying,
"You will obey me, not Rubia. Stay here till I send for you."
Flash enters the slave barracks, and the door closes behind him. Flash must rescue Dale or die trying. Later that night, he tunnels under the wall of Dale's prison. Swiftly he digs, hoping to find a way through the wall to tell Dale what his plans are.
Oh, my, I'm so glad that Flash and Dale each know that the other one is still alive.
So am I.
Now maybe Flash can do something to help Dale, and then they can both escape.
Well, let's hope so, because Flash is in a mighty tough spot.
Yes, but, you know, he is a hero, so maybe he'll find a way out.
Yes, we hope. Now look across the page.
Oh, Dick's Adventures in Dreamland. Last week, Dick woke up, and I wonder if this week he'll fall asleep and have another exciting dream.
Well, let's find out. So across the page we go with Dick's Adventures and say the magic words with me.
Riggity-pack-a-zack-a-zick.
Let's have music for Adventurous Dick. Dick has been talking with his father, and he's becoming drowsy. And he yawns and says,
"Oh, gosh, Dad. Suppose we turn the clock back 175 years. Back to the year when Paul Revere... Back to old Bush.
His eyes close. And in a second, he's dreaming that he's with Paul Revere again, back in the city of Boston in the early days of America. Revere, who was a silversmith, that's a man who makes wonderful things out of silver, is packing some candlesticks and teapots and other things in boxes of straw. Paul says,
"Oh, I've been waiting quite a while for you, Dick. Tell me, can you drive a team of horses?"
Dick replies, "Why, I think so, Mr. Revere." Last picture, top row. A few minutes later, Dick is moving a number of silver-wrought objects from Paul Revere's workshop down to a wagon at the door. A team of bays is already in place. Meanwhile, first picture, next row, Revere is loading on some mysterious, heavy-looking boxes. He doesn't explain what's in them, nor does Dick inquire. They're pushed out of sight, and then Paul says to Dick,
"We're going to deliver some silverware, which Mr. John Hancock ordered me to fashion for him. He's staying at the Clark Parsonage in Lexington. As to the boxes, it's best that you don't know what's in them, Dick. In fact, you might forget that you ever saw them. I'll ride ahead. You follow directly behind me."
Dick climbs on the wagon and takes up the reins, last picture of the row, and replies, "I understand, sir." And Dick drives off. Slowly, through the narrow, clogged streets of Boston, Dick drives the team. A few paces in advance rides Paul Revere, watchfully. As they near the gates leading out of town, first picture bottom row, a redcoat motions Dick to halt. Dick stops the team. The redcoat soldier asks Dick several questions about what's in the wagon. Dick tells him, last picture. The redcoat soldier answers,
"Master Paul Revere's silverware, you say, eh, boy? Very good. But are you quite sure there's no muskets and bullets hidden in this wagon, eh?"
Dick looks at the soldier in surprise. A short distance away, Paul Revere, astride his horse, watches the British soldier carefully to see what he'll do next.
Well, I'll bet you that is what's in the boxes, bullets and guns, because maybe Paul is taking them to some Americans who need them.
Say, you really have the mind of a detective.
Well, I should have. I listen to my favorite detective, Nick Carter, all the time.
I hope you're right. Next week, we'll find out.
Oh, this is exciting, and I can hardly wait until next week to find out if I'm right.
Well, here's something else that's exciting, right under Dick's Adventures.
Oh, yes, Rusty Riley. You know, I'm really worried about that because that slinky Taffy Allardyce, who's Mr. Miles' nephew, is going to do something bad to Big Blaze, that wonderful horse.
And when Rusty told Mr. Miles that he overheard Taffy scheming to fix Big Blaze so that he couldn't run in the race, Mr. Miles didn't want to believe him.
And now Rusty's gone out of the house to try to protect Big Blaze all by himself, and he is just a little boy.
Well, let's read and see whether Rusty saves Big Blaze. So here we go with Rusty Riley. Gallop and run till the road is dusty. Give us music for his horse and Rusty. Taffy is making a long-distance call to the city to a man named Corky. Taffy owes Corky some money, and it's Corky who has told Taffy to fix Blaze so he can't run in the race. Taffy is saying,
"Well, hello, Corky. This is Taffy Allardyce. Now listen carefully, because I can't talk long, and I don't want to be overheard. Miles is going to ship Big Blaze to Cedar Point Track in the morning. Now, what do you want me to do?" No, nobody's watching him right now. There's a hunt club party going on here, and Tex Spurdy has the night off."
Corky replies,
"I got you. We'll have to act quick. There's too much money involved to quit now. Get the key to the horse van if you can. I'll be there in 20 minutes.
Meanwhile, Rusty slips out of the house where the party's going on. Says to himself, "Golly, what am I going to do?
Texas away, and Mr. Miles won't believe me. I've got to protect Blaze somehow.
He runs toward the barn.
Gee, Willikins, I just remembered that old cave that used to be a mushroom cellar. I'll put Blaze in there.
Rusty goes in the barn quickly, unties Blaze, and leads him out of the stall, last picture top row.
Come on, boy. Sorry to disturb you, big fella, but we got to get you out of sight.
First picture bottom row, Rusty has led Big Blaze away from the farm out to the cave, and he says,
this won't be quite as ritzy as your own stall, Blaze, but believe me, boy, right now it's a lot safer.
And then when he has tied Big Blaze in the cave, Rusty suddenly thinks,
great guns, I just thought of something. Those men think Hillbilly's Big Blaze. He's in Blaze's stall. Oh, golly, maybe they'll do something to him thinking he's Blaze.
Meanwhile, Corky's arrived from the city and is outside by the barn talking to Taffy. He has the van ready and is intending to steal Big Blaze. But what neither of the men know is that the horse in Big Blaze's stall is Rusty's horse, Hillbilly. Taffy says,
I don't like this, Corky. Stealing Blaze is too risky. Hadn't we better call the whole thing off?
Corky replies impatiently,
shut up and get busy. This is made to order. Bring that nag out and get him into the van.
Taffy goes into the barn to get Hillbilly. Meanwhile, at the house, one of the guests who's leaving is talking to Mr. Miles. He's saying,
I hate to trouble you with this, Quentin, but I wonder if anyone found a wallet. Mine must have dropped out of my top coat. It had my driver's license in it.
Mr. Miles frowns and replies,
oh, good heavens, Judge Adams. Your wallet? No, it must be on the floor in the room where the coats were. Let's have a look.
And there stands that Goldie, that mean Taffy's wife, and she took that wallet last week out of the coat and she put it in Rusty's room.
Yes, she did.
And now when they look for the wallet, they'll just probably find it in Rusty's room and they'll think that he stole it. And that's just what she wants them to think, that mean, mean woman.
That's exactly what she intends. She wants to get Rusty into trouble.
I think that's terrible, terrible, terrible.
Well, now maybe you can forget your worries if we take a look at Roy Rogers.
Oh, Roy Rogers, my favorite cowboy.
So turn over the page to page six, and there underneath the little king is Roy Rogers.
I'm anxious to know what happened now, because last week Roy captured that old hermit who was setting the fire to the telegraph pole.
Yes, and Roy found out that he was using a great big magnifying glass to shine the sun through and set things on fire with.
And the hermit's mule, all of a sudden he started kicking Roy, and I wonder if Roy's all right.
Well, let's find out. Here we go with Roy Rogers. Ayip-ay-o. Now here we go with Roy and Trigger. Ayip-ay-o. The crazy mule has been tied to a post where he can do no more harm. Brad, who is Roy's friend, looks at the old hermit and suddenly exclaims,
hey, is my eyes playing me false again? Why, it's old Quartz, the prospector.
The old hermit replies,
Nearly blinded you with my big glass, you telegraph varmint. Wish I had. Weren't for your ornery telegraph line, my mare'd be the fastest message sender in these parts after it's silvered.
Then Mr. I.Q. Theron, the inspector for the telegraph company, looks at the large piece of glass and exclaims,
he's right. If this lens was silvered for a mirror, he could send code messages by flashing sunlight.
Roy says, last picture top row, well, no wonder he hated the telegraph company. Competition. Brad asks,
yeah, but how'd the dang thing start fires?
Roy replies, first picture next row, well, the unsilvered lens acts like a big burning glass when the sun shines through it. And I.Q. Theron adds,
precisely. He shot the concentrate ray on one spot in the valley, and presto, a fire.
Roy says, or he could blind anybody coming up the trail. So with the old hermit caught and danger cleared up for the moment, they prepare to return to the camp. Later at the telegraph camp, Brad asks,
hey, what are we going to do with old Quartz, Roy?
Roy replies, oh, just hold him in camp till the sheriff decides what to do. He's harmless now. And I doubt if the company will prosecute him now that nothing stands in the way of the telegraph line being finished. As they ride into camp, one of the men calls,
hey, Roy Rogers, wire just came from here for Mesa City. Bill Langley wants you there, pronto.
Roy replies, last picture of the row, Trigger, that means we ride.
Oh, goody. I'm glad that they ended that adventure without anybody getting hurt.
So am I. And now next week, Roy begins a new adventure.
And I won't miss that.
Neither will I.
Oh, look. Right here, underneath Roy Rogers, there's Donald Buckle.
And I'll read that in just a moment. But first, here's that nice man with something interesting to say. Now, here we go again with Puck the Comic Weekly. And on page 6 is Donald Duckle, good for a chuckle. Say the magic words with me.
Squeegeum, squeegeum, squiddy chicka chack. Let's have music to fit a quack quack.
Today, Donald is at the beach with his three nephews. Donald is showing them what a great acrobat he is. He takes a run, leaps into the air, turns a somersault in the air, and exclaims,
"Look, boys, a double flip."
And then lands and kicks sand all over a picnic lunch which has been spread out by a man and a lady nearby. The man leaps to his feet and shouts,
"Get sand on our lunch again and there'll be trouble, you beach acrobat."
Donald replies,
"Go on. This is a public beach."
And then runs off, saying to his nephew Dewey,
"Watch now, a full twist."
He makes a leap in the air, comes down, and lands on a big balloon that his nephew was playing with. The first picture, next row, shoots straight up into the air, and comes down on a cake in front of the angry man. And the man stares at him and frowns and says, Donald smiles sheepishly, which looks very funny on a duck, and points to a pie in front of him and says,
My, wasn't that lucky? I didn't even touch the pie.
And suddenly there is a... And last picture, Donald is walking off with a pie on top of his head, and his nephew, Louie, asks cheerfully,
"What flavor is it, Uncle Donald?"
And Donald is so mad that all he can think to say is...
Too bad. That really was an accident.
Yeah.
Donald landing on that balloon that shot him up into the air.
But it certainly wasn't an accident when the man slammed the pie on Donald's head.
No, doesn't he look funny?
He certainly does. Well, now, how would you...
Oh, I'd just love to very much if it's Dagwood and Blondie.
Why, it certainly is. And here they are, right on the first page of the second section of Puck the Comic Weekly. So here we go with Dagwood and Blondie. Ramafoo, ramafum, zim, zam, zombie. Conjure me music for Dagwood and Blondie. Blondie tells Dagwood,
"Dagwood, I want everything removed from our attic. It's a disgrace."
Dagwood looks surprised and exclaims, "Everything?" So up to the attic they go. Dagwood takes a look around at all the stuff, and Blondie says,
"All that junk must go."
So Dagwood starts carrying all that junk out of the attic. Last picture, top row, he comes down the ladder carrying a birdcage, a guitar, a horrid-looking picture, and a vacuum cleaner, and books, and an old rug. And he exclaims,
"Oh, it's amazing how much stuff a family can accumulate over the years."
And down the ladder he goes. And by the time you get to the first picture, the next row, Dagwood has a big pile of junk in the backyard. And he exclaims,
"That's my ninth trip."
And once more, he climbs back up to the attic. Blondie and he look around the empty attic, and she says cheerfully,
"Now this is more like it. This is the way an attic should look."
And Dagwood replies,
"That was all stuff we'd never use again anyway."
And then they go downstairs. Last picture of the row, Dagwood says,
"Now I'll call up the junkman and tell him to take it all away. And good riddance."
Meanwhile, Cookie and Alexander are out in the backyard, first picture, next row, looking through all the stuff Dagwood carried out. Cookie picks up a doll, saying,
"Oh, look, my old raggedy Ann doll. I can sew her arms back on."
And Alexander picks out a baseball bat and a stuffed muskrat and says,
"Hey, they were going to throw my stuffed muskrat away."
Blondie joins him and picks out a clothes dummy, which is what women use to hold their dresses when they're sewing them. And she exclaims,
"My goodness, was I this thin once?"
And they continue to rummage through the junk, taking out things that they decide to save. Last picture of the row, the three of them are climbing back up to the attic. And Alexander says,
"Hey, someday I might take guitar lessons."
And Blondie says,
"I can recover this old lampshade."
And they dump the stuff in the attic and dash down the ladder again.
First picture next row, Blondie says.
Now, let's see what else there is we can use again.
And they begin to rummage in the pile once more. A little later, the junk man gets there. Dagwood goes out in the back. But instead of all the junk in the yard, he sees nothing. And Dagwood shouts,
Blondie! Here's the junk man! Where's all the stuff he should take away?
And he dashes back up to the attic again. And sees the attic looking just the way it was in the first place. And he stares at it and groans,
Oh, there's no place like home. Absolutely no place.
Shall we read Uncle Remus now?
Yes, I just love Uncle Remus.
Very well, then. Turn over the page and go past Buzz Sawyer, past Barney Google and Jungle Jim, then turn over the page. And there on page 6, under Little Iodine, is Uncle Remus and his tales of Br'er Rabbit. Hippity-hoppity, make it a habit to give us music for old Br'er Rabbit. Uncle Remus says,
One time, Br'er Rabbit got a letter, and the creatures was mighty curious about what was in it.
Yes, Br'er Rabbit comes into the post office, and the postmaster says,
A letter for Br'er Rabbit from Georgia, USA.
Everyone turns in surprise. And Br'er Rabbit exclaims,
For me?
And tears it open, takes the letter out, and begins to read. Suddenly he stops, because he sees all the creatures standing around him trying to read it too. Br'er Bear asks,
What's in it?
And Br'er Buzzard asks,
Yeah, what's it say, Br'er Rabbit?
And Br'er Postman,
Who's it from?
Br'er Rabbit takes one look around at all the creatures and then shakes his head with a look on his face that says,
You'll never know.
And then walks out of the post office as Br'er Buzzard calls,
Hey, Br'er Rabbit, wait up. Don't go yet.
Last picture, top row, Br'er Rabbit walks home, followed by all the creatures. Br'er Buzzard follows and hauls,
And what's the letter say, Br'er Rabbit?
Br'er Bear?
Somebody get killed?
And Br'er Possum?
Good news or bad news?
And Br'er Rabbit refuses to tell. First picture, bottom row, all the creatures have a conference, and Br'er Buzzard has a scheme, and he says,
Now listen, we'll get the friends from here, and I'll keep your friends here, and you get the friends from there, you'll still be here, come here. Okay?
Br'er Bear says,
Us agrees.
And Br'er Coon says,
And us is depending on you, Br'er Buzzard.
So off they go to see if the scheme will get Br'er Rabbit to show them the letter. By and by, Br'er Buzzard sticks his head in Br'er Rabbit's shack and says,
Br'er Rabbit, I has been elected to make you a proposition.
Br'er Rabbit replies,
I's listening, Br'er Buzzard.
And Buzzard answers,
Us reads the letter. And you get 3 licorice candies, 2 lucky charms, a genuine imitation jewel, and 11 cents.
And he throws the loot on the floor. Br'er Rabbit smiles cheerfully and says,
You read the letter.
And he hands the letter to Br'er Buzzard, who walks back to his friends and reads last picture.
Limited time only. Special offer. Act now. Send $11 in stamps for a set of books on how to get rich.
And as Br'er Buzzard and his friends look very disgusted, Br'er Rabbit smiles cheerfully and says,
Keep reading, Br'er Buzzard. There's lots more.
And Uncle Remus says,
Smart head and close mouth is first cousin.
Br'er Rabbit surely fooled them that time, didn't he?
Yes, I should say so. Well, now it's time for Prince Valiant.
Oh, yes. And the leader has made those 2 kings that were having a war settle down and make peace.
Yes, now let's see how everything ends. So here we go on the last page with Prince Valiant and the days of King Arthur. Eckett, Breckett, Gray Malkin, and Quince. Music romantic for a fair, fair prince. King Hap Atlop, who had attacked the castle of King Agwar and who could not enter it by force, has now come into the castle as a dinner guest. He had come here to capture the castle of Thule, and had failed. And now he's been forced to sit down and talk terms of peace. Naturally, he wants the terms of peace to be such that he can return home without having everyone think he's a failure. As they sit at dinner, he alone is unhappy, for his vow to take Thule is unfulfilled. But last picture top row, Alita intends to fix that too, so everyone will be happy. An important document is set before the king. King Aguar looks at the document, then smiles, and hands it to King Hapatla, first picture next row, saying,
I hereby assign to King Hapatla of the Inner Lands the throne and kingdom of Thule.
Alita claps her hands and squeals with delight and says to King Hapatla, now you've kept your vow, and there'll be no more trouble between our lands. Then she hands him another parchment, which is a piece of paper, and says, now you can abdicate. Abdicate means that now he can sign the other paper, which returns the throne and kingdom of Thule back again to King Aguar. But King Hapatla, last picture of the row, grasps his title desperately, his brain reeling. He has tasted defeat, frustration, an overpowering dose of feminine common sense. And now, triumph. He stands there silently. Alita gives a signal, and first picture bottom row, some curtains part. And two executioners are standing there with axes in their hands. And Alita's voice is saying, too bad you won't abdicate. Well, it's been nice knowing you. Hapatla smiles at this joke and takes up the quill. For the first time since taking his vow, he laughs. And then he turns to Alita, saying, solemn statesmen labor long months on treaties that can be broken in a minute. But you've shown me that simple friendliness and trust are permanent. And I, a defeated king, will forever remember your generosity. And I will also remember never to underestimate a woman's ruthless common sense.
I didn't quite understand what Alita did. Would you please explain it to me?
Well, Alita knew that Hapatla would feel bad going home the loser, so she decided on a plan to make everyone happy. She first had King Aguar give Hapatla the paper saying that Hapatla had won the war in all the lands. Then she had him give King Aguar another paper saying that he would give all the land back again to King Aguar. And that way, it would look to everyone that King Hapatla had won and yet had been kind enough to give the land back.
Oh, well, why did Alita open the curtains and show Hapatla those executioners?
Well, just in case Hapatla didn't want to do as she said, she wanted him to know that he couldn't get away with it.
Oh, wasn't that a smart thing to do?
Certainly was. Now, that's all the time I have. And now here's that nice man with something interesting to say. Well, honey, and all you boys and girls, I've got to go now.
All right, Mr. Kamiviki Man, but I'll be waiting for you next week.
Okay, that's a date, and a date with all you boys and girls. Be sure to meet me with our little friend Miss Honey next week when I read Puff the Comic Weekly. For I'm the Comic Weekly Man, the jolly Comic Weekly Man. I'll be back to read the funnies to you happy boys and honeys. Don't forget, boys and girls, see you all next week. Your friend, the Comic Weekly Man, the jolly Comic Weekly Man.